basically, when I think of what attracted me to understanding more about feminism and religion, I think I trace it back to a lot in terms of my own biography. My parents married across religions. My father was a fourth generation Dalit Christian, and my mother was a what colloquially is understood as a Tambram. So when they married in 1965, there was a lot of opposition, understandably, and in many ways they were ostracized from their own families and communities. And but because I think it was also 1965, and they had sort of both experienced youth in the Nehruvian India, so they had this sort of, I think, great and deep faith in the constitution, and they believed that, you know, in this India you would be able to live free from sort of a religious identity. And so they actually believed that they could get married, have children, and nothing would affect them in terms of their the fact that they come from different religions. But what happened was that I think it did prevail enough in terms of our own house. In our own house, I think if there was anything sacred, it was, I mean, we knew as children things like the Special Marriages Act and all, which we, I think, none of my contemporaries and peers at that time even knew. And so we kind of always thought that there would be rights enshrined in the constitution that would see us through and all of that. But I think always, wherever we lived, in whichever neighborhood we lived, there was this whole, I think there was a stigma attached to our family, which only much later I realized that it existed because of this whole backstory. And so people always, I think, and so the also the association in India today of, if you are Christian, then you probably are Dalit. And, you know, that kind of casteist. So I think there were many such things, which as a child, of course, growing up, I had no vocabulary to understand any of this. But this was what was happening. So somehow religion was this uncomfortable space, which I thought I did not want to occupy, because my parents were seeming to be totally okay with, you know, we grew up agnostic and we were not asked to follow any religion at all. There was no force. We celebrated all festivals. I mean, culturally the household was Hindu, because I think my mother brought that with her. And I mean, this whole understanding that the woman sort of is the cultural repository of the house. So in that way we grew up culturally Hindu, and probably we grew up culturally upper caste because of my mother's family background. But it was never imposed. It was, so, you know, I think I floated around in this irreligious, casteist kind of situation, and didn't realize. But as I started engaging with society, I kind of came to realize that there were these unformulated, you know, gaps that I could not seem to sort of cross. And that got me interested in understanding religion. And then at some point I really did get really interested in Christianity as a religion. I wanted to study it. I did study it. The person of Jesus really appealed to me in terms of, I think, the radical politics that he spoke of and acted on. In terms of legitimacy, I can't call myself a Christian because I'm not baptized. I don't belong to any church. But because of my own sort of belief system, I would call myself a Christian because I follow the life of Jesus. My Christianity is not in that sense. I mean, it would be seen in the whole sort of political engagement with religion rather than the religious engagement with politics. So I have always had this, and as a feminist, so with time when I grew up, I joined the Tata Institute of Social Work, I was exposed to feminism, and I clearly understood the language. I mean, it resonated with me. What feminism spoke of, I wanted to hear, and I wanted to be a voice in that chorus, you know. So I knew I would be a feminist, I knew I was a feminist. But this aspect of my religion somehow didn't fit well, and for so many of my secular feminist friends, they were like, yeah, all that is fine, but why are you, you know, why would you even want to pray, or why would you even want to read the Bible? I mean, it reeks of patriarchy. And so I could never really articulate again my need to occupy both spaces, and how I felt both actually fed into each other. And again, I lacked that vocabulary, I lacked the So when I came to JNU, I knew I wanted to work on expanding the boundaries of feminism. So my MPhil was around the ethic of care and why women choose to take on caregiving work voluntarily. And so self-identified feminists, when they do that, what is the politics that they are playing out? So that was what my MPhil was about. And in that, a lot of women who actually spoke about this also spoke about their spirituality. But I could not engage with that category. I was not theoretically that strong to kind of also bring that element. So I actually just spoke about citizenship and how they saw work at home and work on care as a feminist work. But then when it came to my PhD, I sort of knew that this was a thread that I had left loose and I wanted to somehow bring, you know, some coherence. And while I was doing that, I was reading Radha Kumar's History of Doing, which is a book on, you know, the feminist history of India. And there she talks about, I think it's just about a half a page on Pandita Ramabai. And when I read, that was the first ever time that I actually read about her. I had never read about her in a history book. I had never read about her anywhere, you know. That name had never crossed my, whereas I mean, if I had done my master's in Maharashtra, I would have assumed that I would have actually heard about her, but strangely I hadn't, you know. And so when I read about her, and the first thing of course that appealed to me was the strength of character. I mean, because, you know, at the age of 16, she lost her father, her mother and her sister in a period of 3 months or 2 months, you know. In a famine, so the Madras presidency was ravaged by famine, and they were there at that time. And so, I mean, literally, I can't even imagine what it must be to see a loved one die of starvation or complicated by illness, you know. And yet she saw that at the age of 16. While I read that, I figured that, okay, then they went to Calcutta, then she lost her brother, then she got married in the wake of this loss of her brother. She married her brother's friend, and then her husband died. And, you know, when you think of the number of deaths she encountered, and it ends with, of course, she losing her daughter a year before she herself died. I had also recently become a mother. I had kind of, you know, now I had seen the gamut of relationships that one can have, in the sense of I had lost both my parents around that time, and having to deal with especially the death of my mother when I was younger, and then looking at this woman who was even younger than I was, and for her to have experienced, and yet the tenacity with which she followed her dream. And I mean, this is just one, this is like a, I think, part of what fate had to offer her, but there was also a huge opposition that was very much constructed in, you know, by society. And she seemed to have, you know, faced all of that and just gone on and done her own thing. And I could not even believe that actually someone like her could have existed. And if I couldn't believe that she could have existed in 21st century, the thing that boggled my mind even more was that she was operating in the late 19th, early 20th century, you know. And she had traveled across countries as a single mother with an infant, you know. And I struggled to come to JNU when my daughter was at home. I mean, it suddenly put a lot of things for me in perspective, in terms of what kind of struggles and, you know, what kind of strength that women have had and have still. I mean, just because it's undocumented or not celebrated enough, we don't know of. So that's how I got pulled into studying her life. In terms of her life, I mean, one aspect is this whole thing of how she dealt with grief and loss. And I think later on, after reading a lot of stuff that is written about her, and my own, I think, sort of trying to weave it with my own experience, I see that probably dealing with loss was also in some ways her own way of redefining herself. So her father, who was, in her own words, an orthodox reformer, because he taught them Sanskrit when it was unacceptable to do so. I mean, he fought with the, you know, the Sankaracharya, and he had this long debate, and he won that debate by citing all these sacred texts. And he said that nowhere in these texts is it written that women should not be taught Sanskrit. And so just because they could not prove a point to him didactically, so they had to allow him, but they ostracized him. And so they lived in an ashram, and basically they lived a life of penury and poverty and so on and so forth. So, you know, fell apart for her after his death, because she went to Calcutta, she was, you know, feted as a Sanskrit scholar, she was given the name Pandita and Saraswati, so she was Pandita Ramabai Saraswati, and the Brahmo Samaj really, like, you know, took her in their arms and sort of welcomed her and asked her to speak on education, women's education, and she was doing all those things, and in all of that she was also, I think, trying to work with what her father had taught her and how that was limited. So it must have been a powerful struggle for her to see her father, who was her first guru, also seem frail and vulnerable in terms of not just physical body but also ideas and thoughts. So she, that must have also been a huge thing, and I think that's where Keshav Chandra Sen comes into the picture, in the sense that I think in him she saw this other figure of authority who you know, encouraged her to study the Vedas. That was the one set of texts that she had not studied. I mean, her father had only, like, let her access the Dharma Shastras but not the Vedas. So she, on his sort of encouragement, she actually sat and read those. And when she read that, one can call the rupture, that there was never a rupture with Hinduism, which one sees later on, but I think she turned away from the Vedanta, so the Vedic Hinduism, the high Hinduism, she turned away from a bit, because she realized that there was actually no space for women in these texts. She really wanted, I think, someone to steer her through that. But then she saw that K.C. Sen himself, in spite of holding such high ideals, and, you know, he then married his young daughter, who had not even reached the adult age of 18. He married her off under societal pressure. And I think this is another trend and a theme in her life, that constantly the men that she held in high esteem could not stand by their values. And so this also happened around the same time. And then she lost her brother to cholera. And then she married this lawyer, Vipin Chandra Das Medhavi. And he was himself a Brahmo Samaji. He was from a caste lower than hers. And so they actually had a civil ceremony. I mean, when I think of it, I just find it amazing that they chose to step out of their frame of religion to even, officiate their own marriage, their own wedding. And they did that. And it seems like, you know, her life with him, the couple of years that she had with him, a lot of biographers think about that had he not died, one doesn't even know what would have happened, in the sense that, you know, here was a scholar, here was this brilliant mind, but maybe she would have chosen domesticity, maybe she would have chosen a home, because there was never a sense of home. I mean, there was a sense of family, but probably never a stable home, because they were itinerants throughout their early lives. Maybe she would have settled down to domesticity. One does not know. But his death then really turned it around for her again. I mean, I think he had taken a lot of loans, so she had to sell everything in order to, pay off all the debts. And that's another theme that's actually very little studied in her. This whole emphasis on financial integrity. It's amazing if you see everything that she's done, she has found ways of supporting herself. And this is, I'm talking about, again, late 19th, early 20th century, when opportunities for employment for women, especially financially viable employment, were next to nil. And yet she did that. So there are so many aspects to her that it would sound as if I'm narrating the story of a superhero kind of thing, an unreal person, but literally she did that. So she paid off all that. She came via Madras to Pune at the invitation of the Prarthana Samaj, which was sort of like the Brahmo Samaj, but in Maharashtra. And with them she set up Arya Mahila Samaj, which was basically to promote education amongst women. And that time, I think, because she had already become a widow, and especially Maharashtrian society, and she was a Brahmin, I mean, her father was a Chitpavan Brahmin, so she was seen as a Brahmin widow. And for Brahmin widows in Maharashtra at that time, I mean, even I think their shadow was considered polluting. So here was a woman who was actually in public spaces, she was holding public speeches, sharing the dais with other men, reformers like M.G. Ranade, and also the conservatives of that society really despised her, and there was a lot of abuse meted out to her in terms of how could this widow be doing this. And I think that is when her interest in working with high caste widows became, I think, like, she always knew she wanted to work with women, she always knew she wanted to work on education, but this particular group of women, in, you know, in their vulnerability, they were probably like almost at the same level of, say, Dalit women, or, you know, because how caste was playing out on them additionally over their gender, you know. So she understood that, and it's unfortunate that with our consciousness now we have so many words, and, you know, we have these theories in which we can locate her, but she probably at that time was working pretty much on her own, so she may not have articulated all this in the way that she could have, but she did clearly have this understanding. She understood the politics of both caste and gender clearly when she chose to make this kind of, you know, decision to work with widows. Now that she started that, I think she wanted to, again, you know, she looked for support from the Prarthana Samajis, which are people like Bhandarkar, M.G. Ranade. These are all famous people. I mean, if you go to Pune today, you will find that all the roads and everything is named after these. There is no road on for the name of Pandita Ramabai. Where she stayed, where she set up her organization, nothing is even marked with a little board. But of course, the reformers are now sort of celebrated and commemorated everywhere. So she was working with these people, but again, these people could not take the stand that she needed out of them. They themselves chose not to go right ahead and start a home for widows because it would just be too antagonistic to their own society. And M.G. Ranade himself married a very young girl. He remarried after the death of his first wife. So many things that in their personal lives they were doing, which was sort of contrary to what they stood for, their values in terms of the women's question in that time. So all that, I think, disappointed her, and she really knew that she had to do something on her own. She also deposed in front of the Hunter Commission at that time, which was a commission that was set up for understanding the education needs of the community at that time. She, in fact, Jyotiba Phule and Pandita Ramabai deposed one after the other in that commission, and there she spoke eloquently about the need for women's education, for investment in schools for girls, and also for women doctors. And when she spoke about that, I think she probably made up her own mind that she wanted to become a woman doctor, because there was a crying need at that time. So first she explored Madras, which was the only place in India which was offering education to women to become doctors. But that was not satisfactory, so she decided to go to England to actually pursue medicine. So that she worked an arrangement. Again, you know, she was financial integrity, the thing is really strong in her. So she said, I will teach Marathi to the sisters who will come to, you know, work in Pune, and that is how I will support myself. So let me do this exchange. And so then, and she also wrote a book called Stri Dharma Niti, which was her first book in 1882. And she's the sales proceeds of that, she bought her ticket to England on the ship. So literally she never bought, like, I don't think anyone ever funded her to whom she felt obliged. So she did that. She traveled to England. There she found out that she couldn't study medicine because I think that famine, during the famine years, she had lost hearing in 1 year. So she could not be a doctor, and that's how she then chose to study philosophy, mathematics, and she took up the course of how to be a teacher. So it would be very interesting for, you know, at some point if we have the free time, then we should actually look at how New Leam would like to study, because that is one aspect that I haven't explored too much. But she was deeply committed to children's education, and she actually wrote primers, and she was into Froebel's pedagogy, and she has done a lot of work on that, which is an aspect that I haven't studied, but there is material. So she decided to do that, and but in all of this, she also chose to convert to Christianity. Now, what led her to convert? You know, she herself says that intellectually she was already there. Once she had become a Brahmo Samaji, because Brahmo Samaj itself had drawn so much from Christianity, she felt that intellectually it was just another step, and so she took that step. And she had gone to see the work of the CSMV, the Sisters of Mary the Virgin, the community that she was living with, their work with rescued sex workers in London, in Fulham. And I think that, having seen that, she realized that, oh, you know, your faith can also open up these doors. Like, you can actually serve such communities, which in India, and in Hinduism, you would have to always reject a prostitute, religious space to accommodate a prostitute, you know, whereas Christianity allowed that. And so I think it was these kind of pulls that actually made her eventually take that decision, and she converted. Having converted, because she was, I mean, since we're talking on International Women's Day, I think one aspect that has to be celebrated about her is her scholarship. I mean, she was one of the leading feminist scholars of the 19th and 20th century, I would say, I mean, without a doubt. And so she engaged, she kind of deep dove into the doctrines of Christianity. There she faced, you know, she engaged with them exactly the way she engaged with Hinduism. Ki, how does this work? How does this, this is not logical. So she started doing that, and the church was so, I think it was totally disturbed by someone asking questions like this. So they tried to say, okay, you are an Indian, you are native, you all natives are liars, all natives are vain, you are vain and proud of your scholarship and intellect, faith does not come like that. So they put her down in every possible way just because she was asking questions about her faith. And she, it's amazing that she actually wrote, so there's this whole letters and correspondence that we have now access to, where, you know, you think about it, she's written articulate letters in English where she's been, where she says things like, who are you to decide for me? I have just broken the yoke of men who have, you know, taught me what to do, and now I've come here, and now again you are going to be the men who are going to tell me what I should believe and what I should do. And to think that she's writing in English, a language that she has just recently learned, like, you know, in about a couple of years ago she had actually begun to learn English, and now she's articulating like arguments, you know, theoretic huge arguments about Christianity, about the doctrine of Trinity, all this in her letters. And she's able to counter the other, like the church leaders, and say, okay, I agree on this aspect, but don't agree on this aspect. And they were exasperated with her, and, you know, they tried everything. She said, not in such words, but she kind of called them out on their racism, that just because I'm an Indian and an Indian woman, you are saying these things to me, you know. So she kind of she was able to say that. And she was disillusioned with the Anglican church, the church that she had converted into. And by the time she left for the US, she had more or less, it had become a very disturbing relationship. And one aspect which some people have written about is also about how they questioned her motherhood. Because, you know, the way she was bringing up her daughter, that a lot of people who, these sisters were all basically unmarried. I mean, not to say that you can't have a position just because you're not married or not a mother, but these women were able to sit in judgment of Ramabai and how she was bringing up her own child based on some colonial, sort of some imperial notions of what motherhood should be and what her motherhood is falling short of. So, I mean, that I think was the last nail in the coffin in that sense. Like, I don't think she could deal with that because that was just too personal a thing. And so I think she was sort of ready to come back to India, having failed at sort of learning anything, or, you know, and she kind of figured, I'll have to do things. When she got an invitation from the US to attend the graduation ceremony of Dr. Anandibai Joshi, who is supposed to be the first Indian woman doctor to have sort of passed through the way that medicine is taught in the West, and, you know, so she said okay, she accepted that invitation, she went to Philadelphia. And she was supposed to be just there for, I think, a couple of weeks maybe. But there she addressed the public immediately after the graduation ceremony, where she spoke about what she wanted to do back in India. And she received such tremendous response that what was supposed to be a couple of weeks extended to 2.5 years. She stayed there in the US. And I think if we call her a feminist today, I think her feminism evolved in that time. Because literally, I mean, she was with the first wave feminists. I mean, she was engaging with the people who were part of the suffrage movement, the temperance movement. I mean, she was very much with them and spent time with them, worked with them, lived with them. So she knew what they were talking about. And the liberal feminists, feminist movement, the first wave as it is called, the first wave was very okay to involve religion and politics. I mean, that's what they did. They thought it was a Christian thing to protest against slavery, and it was a Christian thing to ask for equal rights for women. So they didn't see it as a problem. What now in 21st century America is seen as such a big problem. In way back in, you know, the late 1900s, it was not seen as, late 1800s, it was not seen as a problem at all. I mean, they were actually clearly speaking from, you know, the literally from the church podiums and speaking to women and men, saying the join our movement, we deserve to be heard. And Ramabai saw all this, and I think that is where her own understanding of, so, I think, you know, what is now leveled against Gandhi as his sort of nascent understanding regarding race in South Africa. If we, in that sense, contrast that to Ramabai, how she understood the problems of, because she was in the abolition, I mean, she was there with the people who had actually worked towards the abolition of slavery. So she understood the whole movement, and she, I think, politically was aligned with the black women who had come out of slavery. So in that sense, her politics was also far very layered and nuanced, and she had understood all these things in her letters to her daughter. You know, she's writing all these things that I met this person today, you must remember this person, this person fought so hard for her own life and for the lives of others. Like, she's quoting Harriet Tubman, her meeting with Harriet Tubman. And so it's fascinating, you know, how one life can have so many, not only so much exposure, but this scholar in her who was able to, you know, the scholar activist in her who was able to gain from every meeting, every incident, every event that happened, you know, she somehow managed to make it useful or meaningful for her own growth. So then that is when, you know, in fact, the WCTU, the Women's Christian Temperance Union, published The High Caste Hindu Woman, which was a book that she, Ramabai, wrote, her first book in English, and which in many ways is called the one of the first feminist manifestos. Because there she says clearly that Hinduism, the way Hinduism treats the high caste Hindu woman from childhood to marriage to widowhood, is clearly, you know, unequal, and how therefore we must work towards spaces which are able to relieve these women, especially widows. So she was collecting funds from. So when we talk about Vivekananda, Ramabai spoke to the same audiences a year or so before Vivekananda addressed them. And Swami Vivekananda went to address them and say that Hinduism was this universal religion, and that how Hinduism offered, you know, the potential for all the world to be part of, you know, a thought. And in his own way, probably he was interpreting Hinduism in, you know, through his own politics. And so it is not to say that one was right and the other was wrong, but because Ramabai also spoke about Hinduism, and she spoke about the practical Hinduism, the Hinduism that is practiced in homes, you know, and the way it is used for discriminating against women. And what Swami Vivekananda was talking about was the potential of Hinduism as a thought, you know. They are often seen as speaking against each other. And Vivekananda, I think, he was uncomfortable with Ramabai making such open disclosure about the way Hinduism works, because he felt it was undermining the mission of making Hinduism a universal religion. So to him, he felt that these are not things that one should be speaking about. I mean, that these are things which as a society we will work on and will improve, but let not the West know about this, because what we have is superior to what the West has to offer. So in that sense, I think his remarks towards Ramabai are to be seen in that light. But I mean, clearly there is a limitation in that. I mean, one can't hide these things. I mean, what Ramabai did was to expose the reality of the way it was in, you know, upper caste households in India at that time, and that needed to be recorded, it needed to be articulated, and that is what she did. And of course the West used that in their own politics. I mean, so in that whole civilizing mission, she kind of gave them fodder, if you see it that way, because then, you know, they had ki, here is an Indian woman who is saying how bad it is in India, but why should we not intervene? So, but she was very clear ke, whatever we will do. I mean, what you have is really not anything great. So she, that is the thing that, you know, that's the reason why in a way she is not remembered by anyone today, is because she managed to rub everyone the wrong way, you know. And I find that fascinating about her, that you know, because she was able to say ki, why should, you know, why should you take up the responsibility of redeeming the Indian woman? We Indians will do that. So you offer us support in whatever way, but you are not the one who's, you know, put a huge group of the West against her. So especially the Western missionaries in India were deeply, you know, they were in, she really made it problematic for them to engage. Because they wanted to impose a Western Victorian kind of sensibility on women, and she was like, no, the Indian culture that we have. And so she often used to say, yes, I'm a Christian, but I'm a Hindu. But what she meant was, I'm a Christian by belief, but I'm a Hindu by culture. And I don't see a clash in these two things. So like, she chose to remain vegetarian throughout her life, and which is why there is an accusation about her being Brahmanical. I mean, that, you know, because of these lifestyle choices. But to me, that seems like a very narrow way of looking at her. When you see the work that she did, you know, and then to say that, or when you see her letters and correspondence, when you see that how she was aligning herself on the, so clearly on the aspects of race, gender, caste, she was stating her position upfront, without, only that she did not use the same language that we are used to. So, you know, there is this accusation that she never spoke about her intercaste marriage. Maybe it was a personal thing. Maybe she did not realize that the personal politics can have such a, that if you disclose your personal politics, it has the potential to affect other people. Maybe, you know, we now know, I mean, after the 1970s, second wave of feminism, we now know personal is political. Now we all make our personal choices open in a political space. But maybe that was not the sensibility at that time. But so I think some of the, of course, it is true that Jyotiba Phule was working at the same time in Maharashtra, but she chose not to make alliances, or there is no record of any alliances. I mean, Jyotiba Phule has written in her favor in Satsar, but she has not, in none of her writings, captured Jyotiba Phule's work. So there is a question as to why she never did that. And my study makes me feel that I think she really wanted to focus, for some time at least, on upper caste women. And she felt that the only way she can enter that group is by keeping the company of upper caste men, which is how she stayed with the reformers. But at one point when, you know, she came back to India after the US had the funds to set up her own school, which she set up as, and she called it the Sharda Sadan and Saraswati Ka Ghar, you know, upper caste widows came as pupils because, again, she was given legitimacy by M.G. Ranade and Bhandarkar and all these upper caste reformers who were men. And she needed that for them to be able to come, you know, to her school. But it was a secular school. It was an openly secular school. Only that she insisted that there should be both texts of Hinduism and Christianity and any other religion. It should be available for the widows to access. That they should be able to read and make up their own mind. That itself was majorly problematic to many conservatives. But the other thing that she did was that she used to apparently pray in her own Christian practice, but keep the room doors open. And so a lot of girls were drawn to what she was doing. And at some point, a few girls said that they also wanted to become Christian, because in her they saw, you know, Christianity in practice. And that created a scandal. And in fact, that was the reason why eventually Sharda Sadan was closed down, because, I mean, it moved to Mukti Mission, because they saw the reformers could not stand in support of her. And people like Bal Gangadhar Tilak, who were anti her after her conversion, just used this as the, you know, the final sort of blow. So he wrote so many editorials in the Kesari where he called her all sorts of names and, you know, said that she was out and out into a mission, you know, she was a missionary, she was proselytizing, she was forcefully making everyone Christian, and there were all types of allegations that he leveled against her. And they say that because of all this, the kind of climate that was created in Pune, her staying there was almost impossible, and that's how she moved to Kedgaon. But of course, she moved to Kedgaon also because there was a plague in Pune and she had to take her girls out of Pune. And at the same time, there were also two famines, one in Central India and one in West India, where her own famine experiences and the loss of her family, I think she was just emotionally pulled to go and work with the women there. So Sharda Sadan, I think, had about 80 or 90 women at that time, and then suddenly it went up to 2000. in a couple of years, because she went and rescued all these women, even though she didn't have any finances, she didn't have any place to accommodate them. So she had bought this land in Kedgaon, which is 60 kilometers away from Pune, as an orchard. She had thought that, again, you know, this whole financial integrity thing. So she had said, abhi to, you know, I've got funds from the US, but I don't want to make this a habit or a pattern. So she had bought this land so that it would eventually have enough produce to support the school. But at some point, what had happened was that because the, you know, so much of this had happened, she had to move her all the women onto that land. So they say that in the beginning, the women lived out of tents. There was no building also. And many of the women, along with the men laborers, built Mukti Mission. Like, even now, if you get to go to Mukti Mission, you'll see that the buildings are made out of stone. And they say that the stone came out of the land, you know. So they took out the stones, they built the buildings, and they made the land arable. Like, you know, they could grow things on that. And so right from 1900 onwards, women were plowing there. Women were, like, you know, selling produce. They were keeping accounts. Then at some point in 1907, she set up a printing press. And it was women who were making the printing blocks. And so that's the other aspect, that after she came, she decided also to translate the Bible. And she's translated the Bible from the original Greek and Hebrew, not via the English translations. So she learned Greek and Hebrew in order to translate it in Marathi. And her whole problem with the existing Marathi version was that this version is too Sanskritic. And so here what people say is, she was so anti-Hindu that she did not even like this. But I think her understanding was that that kind of Sanskrit use was making a huge gap between the women that were in Mukti Mission, who were basically from Dalit communities. Because after, Sharda Sadan was catering to the upper caste women, but when she went to rescue women from the central provinces and West India, these were women who were the most vulnerable. So in all likelihood, even though there is no data, there is no demographic data, but if one thinks about it, probably the women who were most vulnerable were the women who were from the lower castes, and who were either sort of practicing sex work or something like that, because that's how they could survive, you know. And she rescued all of them and she brought them back to Mukti Mission. So again, you know, this leveling of her as Brahmanical falls flat, because she engaged directly with Dalit women. And in fact, the Bible translation is seen now by many Dalit scholars as her, you know, biggest or the most significant act towards the Dalit theology, because she said that, I want to make the Bible accessible to the Dalit women. You know?